FTL. Let's continue with your calls and thoughts here. We're going to also get deeper into this story. It's called The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly by the Electronic Frontier Foundation, and they're talking about the patent troll who went after Adam Carolla and who, in theory, if successful against Adam Carolla, would have gone after other podcasters of lesser repute, like Michael W. Dean from the Freedom Fiends. And
people of lesser repute, like Michael W. Dean. Hi, long-time listener, first-time caller. How you guys doing?
Welcome, sir. What's on your mind tonight?
I wanted to thank you and me and GCN for our service. I don't know if you remember this, but you guys donated ad time to a radio ad I made for the EFF about defending, you know, raising money for this case.
Oh yeah, that's right.
Cool. And I actually just donated $25
to the EFF.
To the EFF.
Yeah, man.
With Bitcoin.
Wow. Yeah.
Congratulations, EFF, everyone.
Good. I used to play in this rock band, and we get royalties of, like, I don't know, $50 each, like 20 years later somehow.
Like, and $50 a year?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Like, nothing. Like, it's not worth having me do the accounting with the guy to deal with. So I just have him donate my share to the EFF every year,
nice,
too. Because he's in San Francisco and they're right down the street. He just drops it off. Yeah, man, they do good work. They're kind of, they're not even minarchists. They're really kind of leftist, and they think government can be fixed. But, you know, some people that do that, like, fight the good fight like no one else can. And we have to live in a world of laws, so I guess it's good. It is good that some people go out and, you know, tilt against those giants.
Absolutely. I'll be doing it myself here in a few weeks. And, Daryl, do you have a case coming up, too, still? Or you're waiting on a decision,
I've got,
right?
One pending where I'm waiting on a decision. And then there's a case that I'm not directly involved with, but I am responsible for it being filed. There's a ballot access lawsuit here in New Hampshire that was filed by the ACLU on behalf of the Libertarian Party at my request.
It is nice when you have the groups like the ACLU step in to absorb some of the costs of doing this litigation, because it can get pretty expensive. So, Michael Dean, what else were you calling about tonight?
Yeah, are you guys up on the Stefan Molyneux copyright trolling?
The only thing I know about this is what I heard from you the other night on Freedom Fiends when I kind of stepped in as a temporary co-host there. This was surprising to me and shocking all at the same time. Can you fill our listeners in?
Yeah, I want to say allegedly a lot and be careful, because it looks like he's starting to get litigious with people who, you know, point out, people who criticize him. There was this chant, you know, I dug the guy. He's an important part of my path to liberty, but
I like him personally. I found him very, you know, easy to interact with. He's friendly. He's funny. I've met him a few times at the Porcupine Freedom Festival.
Yeah, in the last 6 months, he's been just occasionally, you know, in a 3-hour podcast of dropping mad science, you know, there'll be like 20 seconds here and 20 seconds there of just nutbaggery. Like, without me, liberty, the world would have to wait 2,500 more years for liberty.
Yeah, like, I heard about that. What? And that one's a fairly old quote. Wasn't that like from last year?
Yeah. And, you know, kind of like bashing women. And another one, he went on a couple tirades of someone who sent him like $1 and someone who sent him $3. Like, how dare you insult me with these?
I remember someone sent him $2 and he got mad about it. So then I went to his website, and he has on his donate page, it was the first time I'd ever been to his website or the donate page, and I saw where he says, if you listen to 4 podcasts, send me $2. So he requests $2 and then gets mad when somebody sends him $2.
Yeah.
So I sent him a Satoshi worth of Bitcoin, and apparently he got mad about that and went off on it on like the next podcast.
Why
that he
get
did.
Mad wow. about $2 anyway? He could be $2 poorer.
Because I've got to pay taxes and an accountant, and it cost me more to file paperwork than what I got in your donation. You are a horrible person.
So there was this YouTube channel called True Shibis or Shibes, you know, the Dogecoin dog. How do you say that?
Shiba?
True Shibas, TRUSHIBES, that was entirely composed of like finding places Stefan was inconsistent, like, you know, a video where he's saying you should never interrupt anybody. It's not very respectful. And then like 2 minutes later, he's shouting down a caller and interrupting them and things like that, you know, and putting text on it. And it was kind of a resource for people who criticized Molyneux because you could reference these videos and not have to say, well, watch this 3 hour video and go to the 2 hour, 17 minute mark. And, you know, there were comments on it in text, but it was legally and morally fair use. And he, his business partner who isn't in some department without him, like I've dealt with both of them before, like they CC each other on everything. His business partner, Mike, whatever, issued takedown notices for this site on YouTube and like had it completely taken away. And this
for
is
critique.
A guy
because this well, is this because this no, YouTube was channel a, was sort of highlighting things that they thought people needed to see about Stefan Molyneux.
But it was a DCMA, which is a legally backed by the U.S. federal government copyright notice. And he said before, like, you can use my videos any way you want as long as you spell my name right. And he said they're Creative Commons, which means you can do that with them, but they used a copyright infringement to get them taken down. Now they took down another channel, allegedly. I can't even find a mirror of this channel. Allegedly they took down a much less popular site that was like criticizing the callers on the show. And they said they took down True Shebe's, allegedly said this to protect their listeners, but there were none of the callers in the True Shebe's thing. It was like inconsistent. So, and there were like videos on here of him saying like, I went to three Ivy League universities, and then like alleged proof that he didn't go to three Ivy League universities, things like that.
I just did a YouTube search for True Shebe's or Shebe, however you pronounce it. And the first video that pops up is Rest in Peace, True Shebe's, killed by a statist cult leader that was posted 3 days ago.
Wow.
Well, there's a mirror of it. Is that on the mirror site? The mirror site on YouTube is True Mirror, T-R-U Mirror.
No, this is by some guy named Jim Jesus.
We'll come back with more here in moments. Jim Jesus, where do I know that? I think that's a listener of Free Talk Live. That name sounds very familiar. Hang on, Michael Dean. We can continue the discussion here in moments. Mark came into the studio the other day and said there's been some concern about Stefan Molyneux, so I've been aware of some of this. We'll come back. Your thoughts are welcome here. This is Free Talk Live. .net. As we continue here, Stefan Molyneux, somebody who has always been friendly with Free Talk Live. You know, we've had him on the show in the past. We've interviewed Stefan. We've had him on in real life at the Porcupine Freedom Festival. And over the last year or so, I've started to encounter things that have given me pause with regards to his show, Freedomain Radio, which is a podcast that he performs. Appropriately enough that Michael Dean is calling in from the Freedom Fiends, because we've been talking about the technology of podcasting tonight. And we're going to get back into the Electronic Freedom Foundation side of this discussion. But you brought up these allegations, Michael, about Stefan Molyneux and his business manager, Michael DeMarco, allegedly using copyright to go after a critic on YouTube, among other things. And you were kind of going through a laundry list of allegations.
They're not my allegations. I want to make them clear. They are True Shebe's allegations, because it looks like he's getting litigious, and I want to preface that. But, you know, he complains when people, or he criticizes when critics take 30 seconds or 60 seconds of something he says that sounds like nutbaggery out of a 3 hour video and post it and say it's out of context. But you can't, you know, if you're commenting on three or four things he said in three or four, 2 or 3 hour videos, it has to be taken in cuts out of there to be able to, you know, process it, or you're going to have to go watch 12 hours of videos. But he says the things he says, you know, and he does the things he does, and they seem contradictory to what he has said before and the ethics that he's put forth.
Yeah, and he's pretty much proving that right now if he's backing a lawsuit, which I find kind of strange, because every video that I've seen of Manu, he seems very intelligent, and it all makes sense to me, but...
Now, are you a regular watcher of
his
content?
No, I'm not a regular. I wouldn't say that, but okay. I've seen a few snippets of some of the things he said. I haven't seen anything bad whatsoever.
I think it's fair to say... Now, look, there's something that I think is fair to say about doing a radio show, is that eventually, if you spit enough words into a microphone, you're going to spit some words that sound dumb or poorly thought out.
Yes.
Or, you know, crazy, perhaps. I mean, you might even be absent sleep, and you might not say something that you really intended to say. So there's all kinds of things that can happen.
Or you could be quoting someone...
And then
somebody only hears that, you know, 12-second quote where you're quoting someone else.
And it attributes it to you and changes the channel before they know what the truth is or whatever. Yeah. Right. So there's all kinds of things, misunderstandings that can happen. And because I like Stefan personally, when I first started to hear these things and became aware of them, I just thought, oh, God, no. You know, I just don't even want to deal with this. I'm just going to put this off to the side and wait and see what happens with all this. And one of the first clues for me was when he started putting out the Truth About series on YouTube. And that, to me, was just like a red flag. You know, when a car dealer tells you how honest they are, that doesn't make me feel good. And when somebody claims that they have the truth, I don't believe them. You know, if you claim to have the truth a bunch, like you're always claiming to have the truth, like every video you put out is titled The Truth About and then such and such. That just seems really inflated, I guess.
Especially if it's something opinion-based. That does seem like very narcissistic.
Maybe it is or it isn't. I don't know. Honestly, I haven't watched very much of this Truth About series. I've just seen the titles, and I know I don't want to watch.
It's opinion.
Yeah.
It's opinion. So you took him off of LRN.
I did.
You said that the other night, and a couple people wrote me and said he didn't really explain well why he did that. Why did you do that?
I'd already had some concerns about the whole Truth About series, and then I started to hear more rumblings. Mark had come in to talk to me, and he had said that he'd heard, you know, that Stefan had jumped the shark, and then some comment about women, and then I found the details on some of those comments, including excerpts where it sounds like he's blaming women. There's this clip where he, you know, blames women for getting together, some women, I guess, for getting together with a-holes. And he just goes off on women. It's like it's women's fault that men are a-holes or something like that. I can't really exactly recount his exact position that he was taking, but it was disturbing. And I'd heard enough at that point. I actually hadn't heard before I pulled him. I had not heard about these allegations about him supposedly using copyright notice to take down a YouTube channel that was critical. And I had not heard yet about these allegations of possible lawsuits. So, yeah, I just had, you know, I'd heard enough, basically. Does that explain it?
I guess, but you've had questions about other shows on there before and not taking them down. I'm not saying you should take the other ones down or shouldn't have taken this one down, but you're Mr. Free Speech.
No, I'm really not. I mean, I like free speech as a general rule, but LRN.FM is a network that is not a free speech network.
It's your property.
It's a network with an ideology behind it, and of course, in the radio business, they tell you a lot that a radio network can't be successful if it's all about ideology, but I don't care about whether or not LRN's successful. So,
well, it depends on how you define success.
Financial success.
Right, but you know, and if you define success as, you know, lasting a while, LRN has been successful.
Mm-hmm.
Because I've seen numerous, you know, radio networks come and go in the last like 2.5 years. LRN's been around for what, like
five?
Yeah,
that's true. Success is kind of subjective.
But it loses money. So, from the radio business perspective, you're not going to stay in business very long if you're funneling money into your project.
Right, but so LRN is more an activist project.
That's what I said. So it's not. I don't care about its level of success. It doesn't matter to me.
You don't care about its level of financial success.
Financial success, right? What matters?
You do want people to listen,
correct.
And you do want it to, you know, stayed alive for several years.
But what matters to me is that we have programming on there on LRN.fm that is of a liberty mindset. And that's not to say that Stefan isn't of a liberty mindset. It's just there's just too much around him that concerns me at this point. And I didn't feel comfortable continuing to air his show, what with all of the, you know, the fluster, whatever you want to call this, the drama, the controversy. It just... really started it was the whole Stefan Molyneux is a cult leader thing. And there's something to that, I think. I mean, there really does seem to be a group of followers who kind of do whatever it is he says.
So it's not just the controversy, because you've defended before and said that, controversy is good for radio. It's good for listeners. We don't mind having controversy.
Yeah, I don't want to have somebody on here who is going to be, let's say, indicting all women or something like that. I'm not saying that's what Stefan was doing in his video.
That's what it sounded like he was doing.
It made me uncomfortable what he was saying. So I'm not going to let somebody get on here and start advocating for racism. I'm not going to let somebody get on here and start advocating for bigotry. That just doesn't fly with me.
Have you ever removed a show before for anything other than like pod fading and not doing enough shows?
Probably if I were to think real hard, but I don't really recall offhand.
Well, I don't really see any problem with, blocking people from being on here who are saying hateful or violent things, like, especially if it's something bigoted. And, it just makes sense being a Liberty podcast. It's kind of ideas that you want to promote.
Yeah. Hey, yeah, Michael, thanks for the call tonight, man. Yep. We got some other folks here who would like to chat, and I appreciate your call tonight. Michael Dean from the Freedom Fiends, freedomfiends.com. All right, so we'll continue. And by the way, he was on Skype, which is why he sounded awesome. So if you want to do like Michael did, just contact us on Skype at username lrn.fm, and we'll continue here in moments. Our toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. You take control.